This week, another portion of FEA insights, and I hope you'll enjoy them. So let's go. The first tip is my secret superpower, and that is read the solver manual. I mean, like, don't read the whole thing, or don't print it, like it's more or less 2,500 pages or something. But do something like this. Whenever you encounter a setting, you don't know how it works, what it exactly does, and whatever, just input in your preprocessor a funny number, let's say 134758, and then generate the input file, you know, the text file the preprocessor generates so the solver knows what to do. Then, in this text file, which you can easily open in Notepad, Word, or whatever other software you use for processing text, you can find this value, and it will be attached to a parameter or a keyword. You can copy the name of this parameter or keyword and search for it in Quick Reference Guide or any other book with keywords for your solver that you most likely have somewhere. It is usually in the help files of the software you have. It's a very thick volume, so printing it isn't really an option, but if you search for any given keyword, you will find a very short and a very sweet description of what this parameter means, when it is used, the default values, the recommended values, and so on. You can be amazed how much you will find searching in solver manual. So do that, and you will learn tremendous amount of things. It's a good idea. This tip actually surprised me with amount of comments I've got and a discussion that followed. I figured that this will be something obvious, but even though that's the case and everybody agrees, there is enormous amount of bad reports around. So the tip is do good reports of your analysis. I mean, come on, it doesn't even matter if you are hired somewhere or you have your own company. In the end, the only thing that remains after you finish the job is those text files that you wrote, right? This can be 100 pages of tables, and trust me, you don't want to go there, especially if you're a business and your customer gets from you like numbers, 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 and numbers, and they don't know what this means. Nobody likes that. Instead, do a report that can help you out in 2 years. I was in a situation like that, when after some time, the customer called and say like, hey, we want to change this and that. Could you quickly check in a report, does it make sense or not? And then you open 20,000 pages of tables with numbers, and what do you do, right? So instead, writing text, showing how model works, what you were thinking while doing this is a much better strategy. And whoever will get your report, they will appreciate for you. So there are a lot of bonuses of writing good content, and reports are simply not an exception here. Just do your work, and sure, it will take a few additional hours, but in the long run, I strongly believe it will be worth it. This is perhaps a bit more a business advice, but if you are working somewhere, this will come in handy as well. Always define the scope of what you want or what you really need to do very precisely. I'm often in a situation when someone calls and say, hey, we want a quick design of this, or we want a very complex design of that. Bear in mind that you are an FEA expert. Someone you talk to may not be an expert. In fact, most likely they are, and this is why they reached out to you, right? So it's kind of your responsibility to explain to them what to expect from the outcomes and actually ask them, hey, look, what is your goal in this analysis? What would you like to learn? Because sometimes people expect incredible amounts of knowledge from very simple analysis, and sometimes they want simply to very quickly validate if something makes sense or not, and but since they don't know what to ask for, they ask for everything and they don't really need it. If you from the start be certain of what there is to be done, everybody will be happy at the end, and this is a very important thing, and it can save you a lot of trouble. So just define the scope very accurately. The next one is a bit similar to the previous one, but there is a twist. Before you start any FEA job, be absolutely certain that you have all the inputs that you need. It sounds simple, right? But you will be amazed how often people don't know what you need to learn from them. Like when you ask someone, okay, you want me to design this from your super material of your design, what are the values for it? And they say like, we don't know. So before you start modeling, meshing, do boundary conditions and waste a lot of effort, make sure that the people responsible for giving you the data actually know what they're supposed to give you and are capable of doing so. Because otherwise, you might be left in half of the job without any way of proceeding because nobody knows what the input should be. And this is not a situation you want to find yourself in. The last one today is a bit more advanced, I think, and that would be whenever you have convergence issues, try arc length method. It may happen that you are trying to load a model with the higher load than the capacity, and such a problem will never converge. And arc length method might actually help you solve this problem because it will trace the post-failure behavior of the model, so you'll at least know that this is what happened. But what I really like about FEA Guild, a group I moderate on Facebook, and I really invite you there, is that we have a lot of great insights. And actually one of them come from Alexei, who told me that if you are a beginning in FEA, non-convergent doesn't necessarily come from the fact that you are using too high loads. You can have a model that is wrongly supported, not defined materials. Like, there are plenty of things that can cause non-convergence. And arc length method won't solve a badly done model. If your model is correctly supported, have all the material properties right, the mesh is okay, and everything is fine, then it makes sense. But if you have issues with the previous, arc length won't solve a thing. So be very careful about how you make your FEA models. Well, it's all for today. I hope that you enjoyed the show. If that's the case, click the subscribe button below and we can stay in touch. Also, if you have any FEA insights or you simply want to comment or share your thoughts about what I do, please don't hesitate to comment. If you want to learn more about FEA, just follow to my blog and there's plenty of material there. I will provide you with the link in the description. Thanks for watching and see you next time.